Hey Watkinsville, welcome to our online service. We are so excited that y'all have chosen to come and worship with us. I'm Caroline, I'm a communications intern here at the church, and we really want to get to know you guys a little bit better. If you'll just head to our website, watkinsville.org/online, you'll scroll down, there'll be a button that says introduce yourself. Click on that, it'll ask you things like your name, your location, your age group. If you know that, it'll take you 2 seconds. We would really appreciate that information from you guys, just so we can get to know y'all and learn different ways that we can serve y'all. We're continuing on with our Love Is series this morning, but first we're gonna head into a time of worship.
Sing together, You Make It Easy to Love You. You make it easy to love. You are good and You are kind. You bring joy into my life. You make it easy to trust You. Have never left my side. You've been faithful every time. Oh.
Jesus. There's a reason why the curse of sin is broken. There's a reason why the darkness runs from the light. There's a reason why we stand here now forgiven. Jesus is alive. Amen.
Battlefield. I know. It's when we started this series, and the first time the bumper came up, when I saw that, the first thing that popped into my head was "Love is a battlefield." So I'm a child of the '80s. "Love is a battlefield" was a song in 1983 by Pat Benatar. It spent 4 weeks at number one. And this week, I started thinking about that song, and I started writing down a list of songs that have the word love in the title. I'm going to read a couple of these and see how many of them you can get. I Will Always Love You, Dolly and or Whitney. When a Man Loves a Woman, Percy Sledge, or I think Michael Bolton might have done that. Bigger Love by John Legend. Love Yourself, you got that one? That's Bieber. Crazy Little Thing Called Love, Queen. There is no shortage of songs with the word love in the title. It's almost like people are obsessed with this idea of trying to explain and define love. One of my favorites is Love Shack by Athens Own, B-52s. And then you've got a couple that are kind of philosophical, at least the title feels that way. Foreigners, I Want to Know What Love Is. Sounds very existential, right? And then Tina Turner with What's Love Got to Do with It? Well, Tina Turner asked a question that the church at Corinth might have been asking after they read the chapter we're going to be in today. We're continuing our study through the book of 1 Corinthians. And we're in chapter 13, so find your way to chapter 13. And just to remind you that this was a letter written to a church almost 2,000 years ago, sometime around AD 55. But it's been stunning, really, to see how relevant this nearly 2,000-year-old letter is. It fits our cultural moment in an unbelievable way. 1 Corinthians 13 is often referred to as the love chapter. You may have heard it read at a wedding. Cynthia and I actually had it read at our wedding. But if even if you've never opened the book of 1 Corinthians, chances are you've heard these words. There's only one problem with that. In the context of 1 Corinthians, this has nothing to do with weddings, right? It's a great definition of love, but it is not what Paul is talking about. What Paul is talking about is he's telling the church how the church is to behave and act in a loving way. Paul wrote this letter because this church had more than a couple of issues. Paul's writing this letter. Remember, it's a full letter. When they got it, they would have read it from beginning to end, much like you would read a long email you get. I know almost no one writes letters anymore, but they would have read this thing from beginning to end, so it's important to remember that as we look at this section today, because Paul's going to be referencing a lot of things that were going on in Corinth that he's already brought up. And this is really not some over-romanticized idea of love. It's actually a rebuke. And my guess is that when they heard this read out loud, they might have been a little angry. Because Paul, remember how they're acting. They're causing divisions by their arrogance. They're boasting about who they follow. They rudely won't wait for others at the communion table. They get ticked off at one another, they hold grudges, they're suing each other. And Paul contrasts the actions of the church, saying, look, you guys are arrogant, rude, irritable, resentful. That's not love. So this chapter that we know as the love chapter isn't as soft and cuddly as we think it might be. Last week when we ended chapter 12, it's in the context, this chapter is sandwiched between two chapters where he really talks a lot about spiritual gifts. And so in chapter 12, after he gets finished telling us your spiritual gift isn't for you, it's for you to serve others, he says this, I will show you a more excellent way. And so the more excellent way is this, it's the way of using your spiritual gifts in love for the good of others. So let's look at it. Beginning in verse 1. If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. If I give away all I have, and if I deliver up my body to be burned, but I have not love, I gain nothing. Paul tells us in these first three verses that love is superior to everything. When he's not pitting love against the spiritual gifts, what he's saying is the spiritual gifts that you have really don't amount to anything if you don't have love. Paul's using a Greek word here that's not really used a lot in ancient Greek literature. It's the Greek word agape. The Greeks had four different words they would use for love, but this one is pretty unique. It carries with it this idea that it is self-sacrificing. You have the other person's good at heart, maybe at your own expense. If you think about agape love, it's one commentator says it means the actual absorption of being in one great passion. This idea that you are consumed with the good of another. That's what agape love is. And everything that Paul describes in these first three verses is a good thing. Tongues are good. Prophecy and knowledge, good. Faith, good. Sacrifice, good. But love is so important. Paul is telling us that apart from it, every other good thing is useless. Paul is trying to drive the point home that everything minus love equals nothing. And that's how he starts this chapter about love. Because remember, the Corinthians are all in an uproar about gifts, and they're elevating certain gifts over others, and Paul's saying it really doesn't matter what your gift is if you're not loving. And then he moves to a description of love in the next verses. In the next verses 4 through 8, Paul uses 15 verbs to characterize love. Think about that. When we think about love, we think about it as maybe an adverb, like we would describe it as with an adverb, but Paul's saying, no, love is active. It has to do something. And so the first two verbs he used are positive. He says, love is patient, love is kind. In this context, being patient isn't the same thing as you having to wait in line at Walmart, right? What the word patient in this context means, it's the ability to be wronged and not retaliate. It literally means to be long-tempered or long-fused. You're patient with someone despite the way they treat you. Second, this idea that love is kind. It just means you extend good to others even when they've wronged you. You put these two things together and you see what Paul is saying here, that we are to love each other with patience and kindness, and that means if we're being wronged or hurt by someone, that we don't seek revenge or restitution, but instead we extend kindness and forgiveness to them. Now Paul gives us a series of eight negative ways that he says love is not these things. I think the reason he does this because the church at Corinth and human beings in general are quite adept at justifying our negative actions. And so what Paul is about to get into here in the second half of verse 4 through 6 is this idea of, hey, you're doing this, but that's not what love is. So let's look at that. Verse 4, love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. So let's pull these words out and look at them quickly. Envy is really a strong, passionate emotion, primarily characterized by love for ourselves. We want what other people have. That's envy. It's to be filled with maybe jealousy toward someone. And Paul is saying that is not love. Boasting, it's related to this idea of defending your own self-image. You want people to know how important you are. And so you tell them often how important you are. And boasting is oftentimes a sign of really deep insecurity. You need others to validate you and approve of you. Boasting isn't love. Boasting is too tied to one's self to fit the definition of what Paul is giving us here of love. And if boasting is the outward expression of that, then the root of that boasting has to be arrogance. When Paul says love is not arrogant, that's the root of boasting. It's this self-absorption, this idea that you are more important than you actually are. Love is not rude, Paul tells us. A rude person thinks only of themselves. Think about what's going on in Corinth at the Lord's table. They won't wait on others. That's rude, right? If somebody breaks in line, I know buffets aren't open right now, but if you go to the buffet and somebody breaks in front of you at used to be Golden Corral, that's rude. It's rude behavior. You're not going to be pleased with that. Paul is saying that's not loving. A rude person's only thinking of their own needs and meeting their own needs. Self-seeking is also not loving. It doesn't insist on its own way. Love is unselfish. If you're the kind of person that you get all just bent out of shape when you can't get your way, and you manipulate the system or try to manipulate people just so you can get your way, Paul is saying, listen, that's not loving. Love does not insist on always winning. Love is not irritable. Irritability is a sure sign that love is not one of your controlling character traits. It can come from a lot of different things. Impatience with others. When someone upsets me or gets in the way of what I want, we can tend to get irritable. Paul says that's not loving. It's not resentful. Another way to translate this is it keeps no record of wrongs is a great translation. It's actually from a Greek word that's a mathematical term that basically means to keep a running tally of things, to calculate. And so what Paul is saying is, listen, love doesn't keep a record of how you have been wronged. Love does not delight in evil. The idea here is that when Paul is saying, not necessarily that you love evil things, but that you delight in the fact when someone, maybe that you've got a grudge against or that you're angry at, suffers harm, you rejoice in that. Paul is saying that's not loving. That's not a characteristic of love. What we should be doing, he says, is rejoicing in the truth. We ought to join with others in rejoicing when justice is done. And we need to be able to separate sin being exposed from the person. And Paul says when we delight in evil, what we're doing is we're delighting in the harm of another person. And that's just not loving. As we move on through the chapter, Paul gives us five things that true agape love always does. Love bears all things. I'm in verse 7. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. Love always bears all things. It means to carry the burden. Love bears all things. Are you the kind of person who's characterized by sharing other people's burdens? Do you lighten the load of people or do you pile on? Love always believes. The NIV translates this word trust. It's giving somebody the benefit of the doubt. It's trusting someone. It's not this naive idea that everybody's innocent, but it is this idea where you're willing to believe someone the best about them, the best about a person. Love's faithful to people. Love is essentially optimistic, is what Paul is saying. Love always hopes. It's very similar to that. It's looking forward to something. Love doesn't give up hope. You hold out hope that God and His saving work in your life and the lives of other people is going to do what it says it does. Love always endures. Love always endures. It means no matter what the task or obstacle, you are loving. And finally, love never ends. It means the idea to fall from or to become inadequate for a certain task. And Paul is saying, listen, real agape Christian love never fails. That's what love is. Love is an action. And Paul unpacks all of that in this beautifully written poem. And when you read it, it makes sense that it would be read at a wedding, right? So Paul gives them this definition of love. And then he moves from this unbelievable definition of love to practical application as it relates to spiritual gifts. He says, as for prophecies, they're going to pass away. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part, but when the perfect comes, the partial will pass away. Paul is saying here that the spiritual gifts are temporary. They're given to the church so God can build His kingdom and establish His reign through His people, but they're going to come to an end. He says, when perfection comes, there's going to be no more need for this incomplete form of prophecy or knowledge or gift. And so there's a lot of debate about what does it mean? What does that mean when the perfect comes? What is that? Well, I think it's, to me, it seems clear that that is when Jesus returns to get His bride. That's when I think these temporary gifts that God has given to the church cease, when the perfect one Himself comes to get His bride and we are with Him forever. The Greek word for perfect is telos, and considering the way the New Testament uses that in other passages, it seems like Paul is saying, look, Jesus is coming back for us and we are imperfect. So when we see Him face to face, though, look at what he says. He gives this comparison. Childhood, maturity, and really bad mirrors. He says, when I was a child, I spoke like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I gave up childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I have been fully known. So he uses this idea of childish behavior as an illustration. What he's saying is, in this age, we are so imperfect in our ability to love and use gifts and have real understanding that once Jesus comes for us and we see Him face to face, we will become mature. Think about when you were a kid. Some of the things you believed when you were a kid are some of the things you did when you were a kid. Right? If you did those things now as an adult, people would make some pretty harsh judgments about you. Paul is saying, look, this is an illustration. When Jesus comes, we will grow up into fullness, into being known as we are known. Then he gives the illustration of a mirror. And you might think, wait a minute, I have a pretty good mirror, right? Well, back in that day, a mirror was basically a polished piece of metal. And so it was hard to see if you had broccoli in your teeth with that thing. What Paul is saying, because that's the mirror they had, we don't get a really good picture of who we are. But when we see him face to face, he says in verse 12, we will have clarity and we will know what love is. When Moses sees God face to face in Exodus 31 and Deuteronomy 34, there's this intimacy there. It's what Paul is saying in this direct face-to-face encounter with the presence of God. Is when that takes place, we're going to have a full understanding of who we are and who Jesus is. He says, now I know in part, then I'll know fully. The Apostle John says something similar in 1 John. He says, dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known, but we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. That's good news. And Paul ends with this statement in verse 13. Faith, hope, and love remain, but the greatest of these is love. All the spiritual gifts are temporal. And what Paul is saying is that the one thing that's going to last is love. They become obsolete when Jesus comes for his bride. It's rooted in the very character of who God is. 1 John tells us that God is love. And this chapter has been Paul's way of saying to Corinth, we're almost at the end of the book, but it's taken him this long to get to what the real problem is in Corinth. And if we were honest, any problems we have in the church in our present day are the same issues. We just don't love the way God is asking us to love here. Here, I'll give you a way to test that. Look back at that list where he describes love. Love is patient, love is kind, love does not envy, love does not boast. Do this little experiment. Replace the word love with your name. Vic is patient. Vic is kind. Vic does not envy or boast. If you're like me, you don't have to get far into that list to realize, man, you fall miserably short. What Paul has set before us here is the gold standard of love. And when we read it and we look at our own lives and go, man, there are a lot of times I'm not patient. There are a lot of times I'm not kind. I have a tendency to be arrogant and boast. I'm rude. I want my own way a lot. I'm resentful. I'm irritable. We have a standard before us that we can't meet on our own. But here is the spectacular news. We don't have to meet it on our own. Let's try something different. Instead of putting your name there, let's try this. Jesus is patient and kind. Jesus does not envy or boast. Jesus is not arrogant or rude. Jesus does not insist on his own way. Jesus is not irritable or resentful. Jesus does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but Jesus rejoices with the truth. Jesus Christ is the personification of everything Paul has written here in chapter 13. And the only hope that you and I have of being able to live out this kind of love that Paul and God command us to do with one another is that Jesus has lived that kind of perfect loving life for us. Think about it. Hopes in all things. Love hopes in all things. Who could hope in death? Love believes all things. Who could believe that in death life could come? It endures all things. Who could endure the cross and come out victorious? Only Jesus. I started by telling you that love is a battlefield, which was a song from the 80s. But the reality is, love is a person. Love is Jesus. And here's what's mind-blowing. Jesus loves us. He is crazy about you. And maybe you don't feel very loved. Maybe you haven't thrown yourself into the love of God through the person and work of Jesus. I want to invite you to do that. It is the testimony of literally millions. They start life with one song. Love is a battlefield. And they walk through their whole life trying to figure out, what does love have to do with it? I want to know what love is. And God is saying to us today, there is one song. Jesus. He is the song. Put your faith and your trust in Him. He is love. He will never fail. And He will endure for eternity. Let me pray for us. Father, thank you for your word, and we thank you that, Jesus, you are the personification of love. We have hope in death because you conquered the grave. We believe because you lived a life we could not live, and we are able to endure because your love endured the cross on our behalf. Jesus, help us love like you love through the power of the Holy Spirit. Help us put others first. Help us be the hands and feet of Jesus. Help us rest in the truth that you are crazy about us. And the one true love song is the one you sing over us. And it's in your name we pray. Amen.